basically the advanced taxation exam, and I am your facilitator. You can check my brief profile here. I'm an ACCA qualified, and I have for the last 16 years, I'm teaching different ACCA subjects, and mainly financial reporting, corporate reporting, financial management, and taxation subjects. So the advanced taxation subject is basically the advanced paper of the taxation exam, which is the fundamental level paper in ACCA. And this is the advanced level paper in ACCA. So those who are planning for advanced taxation exam, they must have a good understanding of the previous paper, that is the taxation. But as there is a huge gap between these two papers, so what we will do, we will include, or the entire syllabus of F6 is part of P6. So we will start each and every topic from the scratch, assuming or keeping in mind that the students have no prior tax knowledge. So whatever will be the topic, whether it's income tax, whether it's a corporation tax, each and every topic will be from the scratch, keeping in mind the F6 basic knowledge and then the P6 advanced level knowledge. Your exam paper consists of two sections. It is very important to understand that what is the exam format, how to approach your exam questions properly. So you have two sections. One is section A, comprising of the total marks of section A is 60, while section B comprises of 40 marks. So in section A, we have two compulsory questions. We have two compulsory questions in section A. Question number one, worth 35 marks. And this particular question has 4 marks of professional marks. So it means that 31 marks are for the discussion, for the calculation, and the remaining 4 marks you can get from the professional marks. The question number two comprises of 25 marks. And in this complete section, that is the section A, there will be 5 marks for the ethical portion, for the ethics section. If you know the ethical requirement of the paper, the ethics portion, you can get these 5 marks. And if you are able to get these 4 professional marks, these 9 marks are quite handy for your exam. Problem with this section is that the question number one, which is worth 35 marks, is a huge one. It has a lot of information and have different topics mixed together. So students find it's very difficult to attempt this question on a given time scale. Now, as far as section B is concerned, we have 2 compulsory questions, and both questions is having 20 marks each, covering both the business aspect of taxation as well as the personal taxation issues. Here you have to face with the income tax issues, the corporation tax issues, the capital gain tax issues you have to face here as well. Comparatively, the section B question is not that much lengthy as compared to section A type question. So it's very easy to get good marks from section B. And I always advise to my student that whenever you try to appear in the exam, or whatever is the exam diet, you have to start from section B if you have the knowledge. Because while starting from section B, it's quite easy to get few easy marks from the limited information as compared to section A. But as our course progress, we'll discuss some more examination technique that how to attempt these A type question as well as the B type question. Now in the exam, the candidates will be expected to undertake both calculations. In your exam, you have to deal with both calculation as well as the theoretical stuff. But the calculation part would be nominal as compared to the theoretical part. So you have to be very good in terms of your theoretical knowledge and what kind of theoretical knowledge? The tax rules. Because obviously this is the tax paper, so you must know the tax rules, that what are the tax rule is in your syllabus. If you are able to apply them easily, if you can provide sufficient taxable tax information, either numerically or theoretically, you can get good marks. The question will be scenario based. I already told you in section A, there will be large scenarios, and each question will consider different taxation issues. There will be some tax planning issues. There will be some interaction of different types of tax issues. Exam is a standard 3-hour exam, 3-hour, 15 minutes exam. And tax rates, allowances, and information on certain reliefs will be given in the question. You will be provided with a 4-page tax sheet in which there will be some tax rates, some allowances, some relief information will be given to you, and you don't need to memorize those information. Else, the other tax rules and other tax information you have to memorize by heart, and you have to retain those information till your exam. Now, in this paper, the syllabus requirement is that you have to understand certain taxation issues. Namely, this is the syllabus basically. These are the topics that we have to learn in order to pass this paper. First topic is income tax, that deals with both personal taxation issues. Like, for example, if a person is a salaried person, so whatever he is getting from his job, either the cash benefits or non-cash benefits, we have to apply how to tax that particular individual. Similarly, you have to apply the knowledge on sole trader and partnership business. If a sole trader or a partner is earning profit from the business, then you should know how to tax that particular business. And there are also some further issues pertaining to individual as well as individual business. The next is corporation tax. So you need to understand that if a company, whether it's a public company or a private company, is generating profit, how to deal with this profit, how to apply tax on that profit. Similarly, if the company is generating losses, how to get relief against those losses. Similarly, if an individual business is having losses, how to get relief against those losses. The tax loss relief is one of the most important question, always the most important topic you have to face in your real exam. So be careful about that. And in corporation tax, we have to deal with some the group aspects as well. You will be given some group aspects where there are more than one company and there is a parent subsidiary relationship. Like this, for example, a company acquired 80% shares of another company, and now what kind of tax benefit is available for both parent company and subsidiary company? So there are three types of group structure we have to consider. Similarly, in group accounting, in group taxation, we have to deal with how to tax the branch as well as a subsidiary. If a company is operating in UK, how to tax that company? If a company is operating from UK, but its business in USA, for example, in overseas business, then how to deal with that overseas business? How to deal with the double taxation issues if a company is facing. So we need to provide all kinds of solutions to each and every aspect of our syllabus. Third thing is pertaining to inheritance tax. And inheritance tax is applicable on lifetime gifts. Someone is giving lifetime gifts and gifts on death. That is the death state. So if an individual is giving gift to an individual or a trust during his lifetime or at the time of death, then how to tackle those tax issues? Similarly, the value added tax, which is applicable on consumption of goods and services. So if you are consuming goods and services as an individual or as a business, then how to deal with value added tax? very important element of your syllabus, capital gain tax. You have to deal with the disposal of assets. So if a business of an individual or a business is disposing of any kind of asset, there might be some CGT consequences. There might be some exemption as well. So we have to apply CGT rules and find out the capital gain tax liability of an individual as well as capital gain tax liability of a business. This capital gain tax issue is applicable for individual as well as for the corporation. And a very brief or small part is related with the ethical responsibility of the tax advisor. If your company is advising to another company about tax affairs, then you should know what is your ethical responsibility towards your client as well as towards the tax authority, that is the HM Revenue and Custom. I already told you that 5 marks will be in the paper related to ethics. 4 marks will be related to professional marks in question number one. Now, if we can check the main capabilities you must have in order to pass this paper. So first one is understanding the tax system. What tax system we are studying right now? We are studying UK tax system, and we are studying the Finance Act 2020. And this is the last attempt. This March 2022 exam is the last attempt for FA 2020. From June onwards, there will be a different Finance Act, and that will be 2021. So currently we are studying Finance Act 2020 and we are studying UK tax. So understanding the tax system through the study of more advanced topics within the taxes studied previously and the study of stamp taxes means whatever you have already studied in your previous taxation exam under income tax, corporation tax, CGT, value added tax, you have to learn some new advanced topics in the P6 exam, as well as the stamped taxes of land and building and disposal of other assets. The next thing is that impact of relevant taxes on various situations and course of action, including the interaction of taxes. Now, in the scenario, you will be given a particular situation of an individual as well as for a corporation, and you have to give some tax advice. Like, for example, one of your client is asking about to establish a business, and he or she wants to know that whether to incorporate a business as a sole trader or try to incorporate it somewhere else. So you have to advise that what is the suitable situation, how to minimize the tax liability, how to maximize the tax relief available. Similarly, minimizing or deferring tax liabilities by the use of standard tax planning measures. Like, for example, if you have to pay tax in 2022 and you can defer tax for at least, say, suppose 3 to 5 years, then what is the mechanism available through which you can defer your tax liability? This is the role of tax planning. And then finally, communication with your client, communication with HM Revenue and Custom, and communication with other professionals in an appropriate manner. That means fulfilling your ethical responsibility towards your client, towards the tax authority and other professionals. So on the whole, in our syllabus, we have all these topics. We have to learn the tax rules. We have to see how reliefs are available, how we can minimize tax liability, how we can give advice to our client in a best possible or ethical way, how we can use the reliefs available. If we have profit, how to identify tax. If we have losses, how to get relief and the most appropriate method of tax relief. Now, it is always important to understand that what examiner wants from you. So you should study the examiner reports frequently, and you get the advice from the examination team that what things you have to do and what things you don't do in the exam in order to get the required passing marks. So preparation advice from the examining team, what they are advising to you, you have to carefully understand that. First one is know your stuff. What kind of stuff? That is your taxation syllabus. You must have thorough, precise knowledge of entire syllabus. It's always very important. Then you spare some time to learn all the possible syllabus area, whether it's income tax, corporation tax, because if you miss any part of the syllabus, it is possible that you will get a question from that part, say suppose the 5-mark question or a 10-mark question, and then you have to face some trouble in your exam. So coverage of the entire syllabus is our primary agenda. Then refresh your brought forward knowledge from UK TX syllabus. But I told you that you don't need to have an understanding of the previous knowledge. We will provide you the lectures in such a way that it will cover the entire taxation knowledge from the scratch. And then practice question under exam condition using the ACCA practice platform. Normally it happens that students do not practice enough using the platform. You know that it is a computer-based exam nowadays, so you must have an understanding of how to use the required tool, that is the Excel for the calculation and the word processing document for your theory, and how to connect these documents, how to speed up your typing so that you can cover the syllabus or the examination under the time frame. Learn how to spot triggers which are there to point you towards the required answer. There is always something in the question which you have to understand in order to answer the question appropriately. And be prepared to answer questions on ethical issue. Why? Because it comprises of 5 easy marks. Remember, 5 easy marks available for ethics. So if you cover ethics, you practice ethics question, you can easily get these 5 marks. Now, the insight from the examiner report. For each exam paper, you can get access to the examiner report from the ACCA website. They have some information for you. So those candidates who did not perform well in the exam were weak in the following areas. So they are telling you the weakness of the journal students, why they are not able to get the 50 marks. Number one, they did not have sufficient knowledge of the tax rules within the syllabus. For example, let me give you an example. There is a topic called research and development cost. So if a company is spending money on research and development costs, so you should know what are the tax rules behind that, how much tax relief is available, what is the rule related to small company, and what is the rule related to a large company. And this is the most frequently examinable topic. So if you have no idea about the research and development tax treatment, and if in exam question you find one question on that topic, then you are not able to get the sufficient marks. Similarly, you must know the losses relief, the possible losses relief available for an individual as well as for the corporation. So if you know the desired tax knowledge, it's very easy to get good marks. Next one is they did not spend sufficient time thinking before they start writing. You have to plan how to write. So if you are solving any question in exam, it's always important, give some time to plan your answer. What you have to write, what are the triggers in the question, identify those triggers, and then start writing. Instead of writing each and everything in a haphazard way. No, my slides, I'm keeping my slides. It might be due to the some internet issues. You're not able to see my current slide. Let me just share it again. So now, can you see it moving? Is it fine now? Check. I'm changing slides. You can see. You will get the recording of this lecture as well, so don't worry about if you miss anything from that. The agenda of today's session is to inform you about that how we have to progress with this syllabus, how you have to prepare, so that you will get the insight and then start your preparation accordingly. Now, the second thing, the first thing was the coverage of the syllabus, which is very important. The second thing is you have to write after planning the answer. And third thing, which is a trouble for every student, is time management. Remember that it's a 3 hour paper and it is almost impossible to attempt the 100 marks. So you should learn how quickly you have to answer your question, how precisely you have to answer your question, and how you have to identify whether section A is good enough for you, whether section B is good enough for you, from where to start your answer, whether you have to attempt the entire question or you have to attempt the question from part by part. So it's very important, at least try to cover the maximum marks. Try to attempt the maximum marks, at least 90% plus, if you want to get the 50 marks. With the practice, with practice on CB platform, with practice of many examination type question from the revision kit, you'll be able to get over this problem of time management. But if you're not practicing enough, you have to face this time management problem in your exam. So one thing is the knowledge, other thing is planning, and third thing is the time management technique. If you overcome all these issues, you will definitely get the passing marks. Now, the successful candidate, what they do, it is always important to learn from the successful people. So the successful student in advanced taxation exam, what they demonstrate in order to pass this. So they have identified four areas. If you follow them, you will get the marks. They have a good level of technical knowledge, that is the syllabus knowledge, the text knowledge. Each and every area they are working, they know the income tax rules, they know the IHT, the CGT. They try to memorize the tax rules well. Then they are able to apply this knowledge to the specific circumstances of the scenario. For example, if you have been given a case of a husband and wife, and they are planning to transfer something from to each other and to their children. So you have to apply the concerned tax knowledge on this particular scenario, that what is the right advice for that kind of couple. Third thing, they carefully read and address each of the specific requirement. If you see in the exam question, there are lots of information available, lots of parts available. So you have to identify each requirement and answer them appropriately. Meantime, you can also ask me any question if you have any confusion, if you want to know anything regarding this particular discussion, you can post your question in the chat box. I'll try to answer during the lecture as well. So, question requirement, careful reading of the question requirement is very important. I will show you one of the past paper, and you can see that how many parts are there in each questions and how you can connect the correct requirement with your answer. They take time to think and then try to answer and try to manage their time well. Rather than just writing each and everything, it is always advisable just to get few minutes, try to learn what is the requirement. What is the scenario? What are the key information in the scenario? And then start your writing by planning your answer. If you're not planning your answer, then you are not able to get your four professional marks in any case, because these professional marks is all about a good answer, a good planned answer, a good structured answer. So specifically in question number one, you have to use both Excel and the word processing document, and there are different parts, and you have to apply your knowledge in a structured way so that you will get few marks from this area. Now, whatever the course that we are offering to you, that is the pre-recorded lectures, what you will get if you join our course, you will get these features from our course, the pre-recorded lectures. You will get the past paper practice recorded lectures. You will get the weekly practice session on CB format. You will get the complete notes of your syllabus. So instead of focusing on the book, you have to focus on the notes. You can get all these syllabus from these notes. So instead of wasting time on the book, try to memorize the text rules from the notes. And we will interact through the WhatsApp support group. So if you have any issue in preparation, in any kind of trouble during a study, you can ask any question from there. You can enjoy live session weekly. And we will also conduct some separate exam techniques and tips, videos. And in the live session, I also give you insight about that, how to prepare well from the examination point of view. So this is the intro of the advanced taxation syllabus. If you want to ask anything, please put forward your question. And then I will discuss our first topic, that is the IHT. Inheritance tax is my first topic. And you have to learn from the pre-recorded lectures what is inheritance tax. And then on weekly basis, in the first two weeks, our focus is to practice the inheritance tax question from the past paper. So the live session will be worthy for you if you have the required inheritance tax knowledge. So that would be beneficial then. So first topic that we are going to study is IHT, that is inheritance tax. There are three chapters given in the study text. It's not a very detailed topic. And usually you will find one question or part question from this topic, both in section A as well as in section B. So it's quite important, quite handy topic. There will be some like 10 to 15 marks in your exam question. So let's talk about what is inheritance tax and on whom the inheritance tax is applicable. The live sessions will be weekly, one live session, and there will be a live revision and exam drill session at the end of the session, that is in the month of Feb. So if you want to know the detail, what you have to do, just put a message on my WhatsApp number. I will share the entire information what you want to. Okay. So inheritance tax is applicable basically on two things. One is the lifetime gift. And other is when someone is giving something from the death state. That is, from their will, they have declared that whatever are my assets, I am giving these to someone else, to my wife, to my children, to my grandchildren. So IHT deals with these two kind of issues, lifetime gifts as well as gift on death state. Now in lifetime gifts, we have two types of gift. One is called PET, that is called potentially exempt transfer. And other is called CLT, which is called chargeable lifetime transfer. It is very important to distinguish between these two because there are different tax rules related to PET as well as CLT. So how you can identify if someone is giving gift, whether this is a potentially exempt transfer or a chargeable lifetime transfer? So a potentially exempt transfer is a gift to an individual always. Like, for example, if one person is giving gift to his son, to daughter, sister, brother, so this is basically a potentially exempt transfer. Another thing is a gift to a trust. And what type of trust? A disabled trust. If you are giving a gift to a disabled trust, then it is called the potentially exempt transfer. Now, as far as the chargeable lifetime transfer, all kind of gift to trust in our syllabus falls under this heading. So other than individual, other than disabled trust, for all kind of remaining trust, this is the residual category. So if one gift is not PET, then obviously it will be CLT. There are other lifetime gifts which are exempt. I will give you the detail as well. So after considering the lifetime gifts, we have to identify whether PET is taxable or exempt and whether CLT is taxable or exempt. Now let's focus on PET. This IHT, whether it's PET or CLT, is always applicable on transfer of value. What is transfer of value? This is basically the value of gift that you are giving to an individual or a trust. So sometime this value will be given to you in the exam question, and sometimes you need to calculate specifically when one individual is giving gift of shares to another individual. In that case, you should know how to calculate the transfer of value. The formula for calculation of transfer of value is value of an individual belongings before transfer. You have to identify the value before transfer and then deduct the value of an individual estate after transfer. And the difference is what you have transferred, that is called transfer of value. As I told you, that will be given to you in the exam or you have to calculate. For example, suppose before transfer, the value was 400,000. And after transfer, I have the value left is 2,50,000. So it means what? It means I have transferred something worth 1,50,000, and that is called a transfer of value. So once you identify the transfer of value, you have to identify whether it's a PET or a CLT. Now let's talk about first PET and then you will talk about CLT. Now, this transfer of value is taxable. Fine. This transfer of value is taxable, but there are certain kinds of exemptions available that will reduce this transfer of value. So you need to understand what kind of exemptions are available. So we have one exemption, which is called a small gift exemption. If your gift falls under a small gift exemption, there is no tax. Another is called the wedding exemption. There are some exemptions when you are giving gift on occasion of wedding. And there is another exemption, which is called the annual exemption. These are the basic exemption I'm talking about right now. Other than that, we have some more exemptions available. But for the time being, I'm discussing the few basic one. In order to get this small gift exemption, the gift value must be up to £250 per person per annum. If the gift value is under this 250 value, up to this 250 value, such kind of gifts are not taxable. You can claim the exemption. On wedding, it depends on who is giving you the gift. If parents are giving the gift, there are different rules. If grandparents are giving the gift, or bride to groom, there is another. And if other are giving gifts, relatives, friends, and family members, then there are other rules. The wedding exemption rule is different. So from the parents' point of view, if they are giving gift to their children, the exemption amount is 5,000. The grandparent and the bride to groom is 2,500 worth exemption. And for others, it is only 1,000 pound exemption. Now, for example, say suppose the parent has given a gift worth 60,000 pound, and that is on occasion of the wedding of their daughter. So now we know that transfer of value is 60,000. This is the transfer of value, but you will claim one exemption, that is on the occasion of wedding. And who is providing the gift? The gift has been provided by the parent. So you will get 5,000 exemption, and the remaining amount to be taxed is now 55,000. So the wedding exemption will give you some sort of deduction from the transfer of value. Now, as far as the annual exemption is concerned, for each tax year, we have annual exemption available. Suppose we are talking about tax year 21, 22. So for this current year, the annual exemption is 3,000 pounds. For each year, there is an annual exemption of 3,000 pounds per annum, not against the per gift. This is not against each gift. This is the annual exemption. And you can also get the last year annual exemption if you have not utilized your last year annual exemption. You can claim this annual exemption in the current year as well. So it means the maximum annual exemption you can offset from the transfer of value is 6,000. So find out the transfer of value, find out the relevant exemption, and then deduct all possible exemption from the transfer of value. And in return, what you will get? So transfer of value, if it is given, fine enough. If it is not given, you have to calculate. And then from this transfer of value, deduct all possible exemptions available. And then you will get a value which is called chargeable amount. So initially we are looking for this chargeable amount in order to apply the tax rate. So there are two things you should learn properly: how to calculate transfer of value if it is not given, how to get the required exemption. If required exemptions are there, you have to memorize. These exemptions will not be given you in the tax sheet. So you need to memorize how many exemptions are available, in what situation you have to apply those exemptions. I've mentioned few exemptions here. One is a small gift, other is wedding exemption, another is annual exemption. So let's have a look towards my notes. Let me show you that what kind of notes you will get from these recorded lectures. And that will cover the entire syllabus in an effective way. So the first chapter of the IHT first chapter, let me open it up. Can you see my slides of inheritance tax? So you can see these are the notes through which you have to prepare. Instead of the book, you will memorize your text rule from these slides. The registered student will get those slides. They can download these slides as well. The lectures are non-downloadable, but these slides are downloadable, that they can take the printout as well. And what they have to do, they have to memorize rule from there. So this is quite handy as compared to the textbook. Now let's talk about the something from the notes. Let's talk about the exemption that I told you. Now we can see here, we have certain exemptions available. One is the annual exemption. The first 3,000 of gift each tax year is exempt. Any unused annual exemption is carry forward a maximum of one tax year for use after that year's own annual exemption. For example, your concerned tax year is 2022. You get a tax, a gift that is worth transfer of value 50,000. So you have annual exemption of the current year, that is 3,000 available. Now check, is the slides are fine now? Sometimes it happens due to the slow internet connection that you're not able to see the slides properly. Okay, so this is the first annual exemption, that is 3,000 of the current year. And if you have not utilized in the previous year, you can also deduct the previous year 3,000. So it means total 6,000 is available and now your chargeable amount is 44,000. Now the second one, the marriage exemption, I already told you, a gift in consideration for marriage is exempt up to a certain limit. For each of the parent of the bride or groom, the amount 5,000 is exempt. For remote ancestors, for example, grandparents, and the party to the marriage, that is the bride to groom or groom to bride, the limit is 2,500. And for others, such as the friends, the exemption is 1,000. So memorize these exemptions. If you recall in the exam, you will get the marks. Now, as far as the small gift exemption is available, gift up to 250 per person, this means person, per tax annum, per tax year are exempt. However, if the limit is exceeded, the exemption is lost. What it means? For example, I have given a gift worth 200 to someone. As this gift is under 250, so this one is exempt. But if you have given gift of 300 to someone, this is not exempt because now the limit is crossed. And if you are giving a gift to one single individual, for example, a gift worth 50, then gift worth 50, then gift worth 60. So if the total value in a given tax year is under 250, that is exempt. If it exceeds 250, the entire value is taxable. The fourth one is normal expenditure out of income. Now, sometimes it happens that parents are supporting their kids. They are expending money on them. And if it falls under the normal expenditure rule, then there will be no IHT on that. For this exemption to be claimed, the donor, the person who is given the gift, must show a regular pattern of giving. Also, the donor must have enough income left to retain their normal standard of living. For example, if parents are bearing the educational expenses of kids, so this is what the normal expenditure out of income. So you will get the exemption under normal expenditure out of income. No tax has to be paid on these kind of transfer of value. Similarly, There is some political party exemptions. There is some charity exemption as well. So if you are giving any lifetime gift or on death state, any kind of gift to a charity, so such gift to recognize or register charities are exempt, whether they are made during the individual's lifetime or at the time of death. And there is no maximum limit to this exemption. For example, the value might be 500,000, it might be 1 million, any kind of value. Similarly, in order to get the political party exemption, you have to check. Gift to qualifying political parties are exempt, whether they are made during the lifetime or on death. And again, there is no maximum limit to this kind of exemption. But there is a condition: a donation to a political party qualify for such exemption if at the last general election preceding the transfer of value, either of the following conditions are met. Either of the following condition. What is the condition? Two members of that particular political party were elected to the House of Commons, or one member was so elected and at least 150,000 votes were cast for that particular party. So if anything given against the political party, any kind of donation, any kind of transfer of value, and something has been given against the how much vote has been cast, you have to check these two conditions. So overall, we have annual exemption. This is available for lifetime gifts. Marriage exemption, again for lifetime gifts, small gift for lifetime. And then we have political party exemption, which is applicable on both lifetime as well as on death state. And similarly, the charity, the lifetime as well as on death state. There are a few exemptions as well. Gifts to non-profit making institutions are, with treasury approval, exempt. For example, gifts to a number of national institutions are also exempt. With non-profit making institution, with national institutions such as the British Museum, you're giving any kind of gift to them, the National Gallery, the approved museum, libraries and art galleries, the National Trust. So you have to update your exemption list, and it's quite important that in an exam question, you will find out the exemption and you write this particular kind of gift is not taxable. Why? Because it falls under the category of exemption. Now let's revert our discussion again to what we are discussing, that there are two types of lifetime gift. One is called the potentially exempt transfer. I already told you, IHT is applicable in lifetime gifts as well as on death state. We are focusing right now on lifetime gifts. So lifetime gifts might be a PET or it might be a CLT. So let's talk about PET. For example, you have identified a lifetime gift as PET, and the gift date is, suppose, 15th August 2021. Now, the PET at the time of transfer is not taxable. It's exempt. There is no burden on the donor, the person who is giving the gift, and donee, the person who is receiving the gift. There is no tax on each party. It's 100% exempt. But after the gift, you have to check the death of donor. It's quite interesting rule established by the UK tax authority that if an individual transferred to another individual any kind of gift falls under the potentially exempt transfer. At the time of transfer, there is no tax. It's 100% exempted. But at the time of death, if that particular donor die within 7 years of transfer means the gift date, you have to check whether that person died within 7 years. Then what would be the rule? Then this PET is taxable noun. But if that particular person survived the 7 year rule, die after 7 years, means 7 years in 1 day or 2 day. So in that case, the PET is completely exempt, means no tax is to be paid by the donee. So whenever you will be giving a PET, you have to check the death of the donor. If the donor die within 7 years, the PET is taxable at the time of death. And if that person die after 7 years of making the gift, then there is no tax on this particular PET. I will discuss the format through which you can calculate tax at the time of death. But at the time of transfer, there is no tax. But even if there is no tax, you have to identify what is the transfer of value and then deduct what are the exemptions available and then find out the chargeable amount. There is a purpose for that. Although there is no tax at the time of gift, but there is a purpose. That's why we are using this chargeable amount value. Now, as far as the CLT is concerned, I told you what is the definition of CLT. If a gift is not classified as PET, that would be part of CLT. So at the time of transfer, what is the tax rule? And on death of an individual, what is the tax rule? So at the time of transfer, it is taxable, not exempt. And tax is either to be paid by donor or it might be paid by donee. Both can decide to whom the tax is to be paid. If donor has decided to pay tax, the required tax rate would be 25%. And if donee has decided to pay, then the tax rate would be 20%. And this 20% is given in tax sheet. Let me just show you what kind of tax sheet will you get in the exam. Let's see what kind of tax sheet you will get in the exam. Give me 1 minute. Can you see it, the tax sheet? This is a tax sheet will be given to you in the exam. This is the tax rates and allowance sheet. And you can see here, page number one, you have some tax rules given about income tax, the residence status. In the next page, we have some rules related to car benefits, fuel benefits, property income, pension income. In the next page, we have capital allowances. We have corporation tax rates, we have value-added tax rates, and in the last page, we have inheritance tax. So you can see here, the inheritance tax, just check. The rate of tax, lifetime rate is 20%. And I told you that if donee is paying tax, the rate is 20%. But if donor has to pay tax, the rate is 25%. It is not given here. So it means certain things you have to memorize, which is not given here. But there are these four pages contain lots of information. So this is a sigh of relief. These you don't need to memorize. And this will be given to you in the exam with your paper. This will be available. Okay. So let's get back to our discussion. Along with, let me check one of the past paper. Let me show you past paper as well. This is the kind of past paper. Although it's not in CB format, but this is the kind of a sample paper. You can see the question paper, 3 hours and 15 minutes. The question paper is divided into two sections. Both questions are compulsory. Both questions are compulsory. And this is the text sheet along with that paper. You can see. Now this is start of section A. See question number one. See the information. It's huge information. One page, second page. And on third page, you have the required part question. You can see here, A part, B part, and in B, 1, 2, and 3 comprises of 9, 3, and 3. C part in D is 4. And you can see here, professional marks will be awarded for the, for what things they are awarding professional marks for: approach taken to planning the content, the clarity of the explanation and calculation, the effectiveness within which the information is communicated, and the overall presentation and style of your notes. You will get these 4 marks. So at least if you have structured your answer well, although answer is not correct, but if you structured your answer well, you can get few professional marks from this particular paper. So this is worth 35 marks, a huge one. And you have to learn from our sessions that how to handle such kind of question. Check the required length. Now, as far as two is concerned, question number two worth 25 marks. It's not that lengthy as compared to question number one, but again, very lengthy question. So there are 3 parts. One is 13, other is 8, third one is 4, and it's worth 25 marks. Section B, not that lengthy. Question number three, you can see the length of the question. Just one page. And on the second page, you have 3 requirements or 4 requirements. Similarly, question number four, you can check just one page information. And on the next page, there is 4 requirements. I already told you that you will get many part of the question. And if you are good enough in few parts, okay. Now see, in question number four, in first part, they're asking about explain why this company is classified as a closed company. So don't need to put some calculation here. It's only the theoretical topic. Now, during your preparation, if you're able to study that which company is classified as a closed company, then you have to apply your knowledge in this particular scenario that why this particular company is classified as a closed company. The information has been given about the company. So you have to identify whether this is a closed company or not. Now see the next one. In the part B, they are saying that explain, but with supporting calculations. So for this 5 marks, you have to explain the tax rule with calculations. You have to do some calculation as well. Okay. So you can see in each question, there is explanation with support calculation. Sometimes there is only explanation. Sometimes there is only calculation. So you might get some question on calculation. You might get majority of the question on the theoretical part. So your theory, your text knowledge must be. Any question up till now? If you have any question in your mind. So we were discussing about the lifetime gifts and we were talking about the chargeable lifetime transfer. Well, that's good that you are understanding what I'm telling you right now. Okay, so if the gift is classified as CLT, I already told you at the time of transfer, there is a tax liability. Who will pay tax? It is their option available, their choice. Donor can pay tax, donee can also pay tax. They can mutually decide to whom the tax is to be paid. And after paying this 20% or 25% tax, if donor die and there is the same situation in PET, if donor die within 7 years or after 7 years, then you have to check. The rate is different. The reason of difference in rate, because this particular gift is considered as, this particular gift is considered as a net gift. So when we gross it up, the rate 20% becomes 25%. And this is considered as a gross gift. That's why rate is different, just because of the consideration of gross or net. So you don't need to consider this one. Just memorize that if donee is to be paid tax, it's 20%. If donor has to be paid tax, the rate is 25%. You don't need to justify. You have to just apply in the calculation that whether I have to choose 25% or I have to choose 20%. And if the gift is classified as a net gift, then you have to convert this net gift into gross gift. This I will show you in my calculation. Now, on death, for example, the date of gift, let's assume that date of gift was 15th August 2018. And death is on 31st December 2021. Now count from 15th August 2018 till 2021. How many years have been passed? It's 19, 1 year, 20, second year, 21, third year. So it means 3 years and few months. So that means within 7 years, it means additional tax is to be paid now. Some more tax on death. Who will pay that tax? Obviously, donee, because donor is no longer available now. So obviously, tax is to be paid by donee. And what is the rate now? The rate is 40%. Now, you have already paid 20% tax or 25% tax. So you will get relief against this tax that you have already paid. But the tax rate will be applicable on particular liability is 40%, and you will get the tax credit, whatever you have already paid. And if donors survive the 7 years rule, there is no further tax. Whatever you have paid during lifetime, that is enough. No further tax you need to pay. Okay. Now, let's discuss the format. Let me check the required notes. You can see the format as well. Can you see my slides? Can you see the slides? Now, if you want to know what is chargeable lifetime transfer, you can see here, a chargeable lifetime transfer is a transfer made in lifetime into a trust. Expect a charitable trust and those treated as PET. With a CLT, IHT is chargeable at the date of the gift. You can see using the nil rate band in force at that time. We'll discuss that nil rate band subsequently. And now you can see a chargeable lifetime transfer is a transfer made in lifetime to a trust. It is immediately chargeable to IHT. Tax is to be paid by either donor or donee. Donor rate is 25% and gift is treated as net. Dhoni tax rate is 20% and the gift is treated as gross. You can see how handy these notes are. After reading this particular slide, many of the theoretical aspects are now clear, and you have to produce these in your exam. You have to explain just. Now further, you can see here the format. Now check the format. What you have to show? First of all, you have to show the transfer of value. You have to identify. It might be given in the question, or you have to calculate. Then there are exemptions available. Whatever are the exemption? One exemption I did tell you is inter-spouse exemption. If husband is giving gift to wife or from one party to another, civil partner, this is exempt both for lifetime as well as at the time of death. Keep in your mind. Other exemption includes the wedding exemptions, the annual exemptions. After that, you will get a chargeable amount. And from this chargeable amount, there is a deduction called NRB, that is the nil rate band. You have to understand why this is a nil rate band, how to calculate the value, and then you will get a taxable amount. This is the amount on which you have to apply tax. How much tax rate is to be applicable? It depends whether the donor is giving tax, which is 25%, and if Dhoni is giving tax, the rate is 20%. And if you apply this, this is the IHT payable during lifetime. Then what you have to do? You have to identify the gross chargeable amount carried forward. We need this for subsequent gift. So after finding out the IHT liability, we have to identify what is the gross chargeable amount. Now see, if Dhoni trustee pay the tax, the gift is referred to as the gross gift. The rate is 20%. If donor pay its net gift, the rate is 25%. You can see why it's 25% due to the difference between net and gross. And these are the annual exemption. I already told you about that. Now it is the time to discuss one thing and then the calculation. This is our introductory session, so it will be a short one for today. And from next live session, we have a standard fixed time for the live session, that is on Sunday, because Sunday is quite convenient for all of you, because I'm teaching global students. So everyone is normally free on Sunday. And if someone is not able to get the live lectures, you will immediately get the recording of that particular live lecture as well. So don't worry about that. If you miss this live lecture due to your personal commitments, family commitments on Sunday, you can immediately get this, the recording as well. So the lecture is quite flexible. The recorded lectures are very handy. You can use whatever time on whatever device. The access will be given to you till your exam. There will be a live revision session. Remember, the revision session and the exam drill session will be live too. So there will be approximately 15 hours live revision session will be available to you. I'm available on WhatsApp. Every time you need to ask any question, you need any advice, you can have my WhatsApp number always. So we'll try a level best to facilitate you so that you can pass this paper in the first attempt. Or if you're not able up till now, you can easily pass in the next attempt. So last thing I'm about to share with you, and then we'll conclude this session for today. So as you can see the format, let me write it again. First, you have to identify the transfer of value. Let me put some figures here. The transfer of value is suppose 3,50,000. Let's assume that it is given in the question. Then there is only annual exemption available. So you deduct the annual exemptions. an annual exemption is, one is the current year annual exemption. How much is that? 3,000. And another one is the last year, 3,000. Always take the current year first. Last year, if it is unutilized, then deduct 6,000 and we have 3,45,000 chargeable amount. Assuming this gift is tax is to be paid by trust. And who is trust? Trust is Dhoni. I'm assuming that Dhoni is to be paid tax. So this gross chargeable amount is classified as chargeable amount is called the gross chargeable amount. Now, from this, we have to deduct NRB, the nil rate band. This is quite complex in IHT. I will discuss in the subsequent class that what is the rule of NRB. You can check from the recorded lecture if you have. So each year you will be given the NRB value. From where you have to see the NRB value, you can just see here you can check here the NRB value. You can check here. These are the nil rate band available for each tax year from 2021 till you can see 2007. So your gift will fall in any kind of this year. You can see starting from 2,85,000. 3,12,000. Now it's quite common to have the same value, that is 3,25,000. So let assume that NRB is standard 3,25,000. So after deducting NRB, the taxable amount, how much is the taxable amount? Can you identify how much is the taxable amount? I guess it's 19,000. Correct me if I'm wrong. This is the taxable amount. So tax, what would be the rate? As I assume that Dhoni is to be paid tax, so the tax rate is 20%. And how much is the tax liability? This is the IHT payable. And then underneath this, you have to write gross chargeable amount. And if this is a gross chargeable amount, just copy this value. So gross chargeable amount is 3,44,000. IHT payable is 3,800 and gross chargeable amount is 3,44,000.